She's an icon for today's young Indians who are inspired by her talent, drive, passion, and charisma. Much loved and admired as an artist, she's also a power player in her own right, who has broken through the glass ceiling to reach international stardom. Featured on the cover of Time magazine as one of the 100 most influential people in the world, she has always been a pioneer, pushing boundaries, navigating tough terrain, and going where no woman has gone before. She captured the imagination of the entertainment world and caught the attention of the West with a hit TV show, ABC's Quantico, for which she won the People's Choice Award for 2 consecutive years. She made her Hollywood debut with Baywatch, and in no time has already become an established Hollywood star with 2 upcoming films. She was most recently announced as UNICEF's Global Goodwill Ambassador and became part of Variety's coveted Power of Women honorees that pays tribute to some of Hollywood's most philanthropic women whose efforts have made a significant impact to their chosen charities and causes. What has defined her journey is her determination and her commitment to chasing her dreams. And this is what she will be speaking to us this evening about, breaking the glass ceiling, chasing a dream. Her lecture will be followed by a conversation with Sonia Singh. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome actor, singer, producer, philanthropist, and global icon, Priyanka Chopra.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. मेरी आवाज सुनाई दे रही है? Thank you so much. लेकिन आज मेरी आवाज थोड़ी नासाज है, so please forgive me. I might sound a little extra sexy. Thank you guys. Major love right back. It's so good to see so many of you, I guess, excited to hear what I have to say. I better make sure I have something good to say now. Pata chale, I'm saying something and none of you get why I actually am saying what. So, should we start? Are you curious why I chose to talk about breaking the glass ceiling? No, somebody said no. What are you curious about then? Me. That's exactly the point. I'll tell you guys about me through what I'm going to talk about. So first and foremost, good evening and a big hand, big round of applause to all of you. I cannot tell you how happy I am to be here today and to actually be talking to all of you. This is the second time I've been in this auditorium and each time it's been so wonderful. I just want to thank Shobha ma'am, Shobha Day, who actually asked me to do this. We'll find out after this session how much I want to actually thank her. Penguin Random House, who asked me to come here. Mr. Sanjay Gupta, Hemali Sodi, Nandan Shah, Sonia Singh, who's going to be asking me a lot of questions after this is over on this couch, and I'm pretty sure she's going to grill me a lot. But before we start, can I ask all of you something? Would you mind doing something for me? No? Yes? No, then you must go out. Out. All right, raise your hands when I count to 3 and stand up if you can and just start cheering and clapping. 1, 2, 3. Clap. Yes. ये जरा रिकॉर्ड कर लेना. आई जस्ट वॉन्टेड टू इंश्योर दैट आई कुड टेल एवरी वन आई गॉट अ स्टैंडिंग ओवेशन ऑन माई स्पीच. गाचा. थैंक यू. So my father used to always tell me something which I want to share with you. That why do you want to fit inside a glass slipper? You know, like we were told, like Cinderella did, why do you want to fit inside a glass slipper when you can shatter the glass ceiling? I want to tell you a little secret. I'm not very fond of this phrase, breaking the glass ceiling. Why does it annoy me? Because it takes the context of everything that I have done, all my achievements, all my hard work, and puts it into a box. As if my ambition was, kire, I want to find a glass ceiling and break it. Not at all. To be really honest, I was never in a mission to break, to shatter anything. All I wanted was to chase my dreams, my ambitions. I wanted to evolve. I wanted to become the best version of me that I could be. And of course, in Priyanka Chopra style, along the way, I wanted to smash and break every obstacle that came my way, which I did. But that does not mean that the glass ceiling doesn't exist. Of course it exists. And countless of women and men, mostly women, run into it in their professional and personal lives. And I'm sure a lot of you can vouch for that right now. The Oxford Dictionary definition of the glass ceiling is an unacknowledged barrier to advancement in a profession, especially affecting women and members of minorities from rising beyond a certain level in a hierarchy. And this metaphor was first coined by feminists in reference to barriers in careers of high-achieving women. So why did I choose it as my topic for today if I hated it so much? Because I hope through my experiences, I can present to you the tools to live your dream and to not make that glass ceiling that is defined by society, largely patriarchal, as your goal. I want you to aim higher because you know you can. And it's honestly all I did. Every step of the way, all I did was set a higher standard. How did I get here? By being fierce, by being fearless, and by being flawed. Completely and utterly flawed. I'm not perfect, like none of us are. So tonight I'm going to try and break it down for you a little bit in a slightly different way. I present the 12 sure shot, surefire ways of becoming Priyanka Chopra. Would you like that? Sorry, I was just kidding, because us millennials, we don't like to be told what to do. So this is a gentle nudge in the right direction. Presenting PC's 12 rules of becoming the best version of yourself. So here are a few of my favorites from my list. There's only one you, okay? Because there's no one like you. And I don't mean the superfluous, superficial parts. I'm talking about the core of you, who you are inside, your values, your beliefs, your flaws. And once you understand who really that person is, you would have taken the first step in finding your unique self. And that is the best version of you. Who am I really? Most often, we don't allow ourselves the ability to dream beyond our imagination. We don't allow ourselves to think about the future because we are afraid of change. We are afraid to move away from what is familiar. Either that or sometimes, you know, we are too rigid to let our dreams evolve. Just loosen up, you know, shake it off a little bit. Change is the only constant thing in life, and you are never too old or never too experienced to learn something new. Believe that you have everything already as your Brahmastra in your will to be able to be and achieve your dreams. Be fearless. I know I wanted to become an aeronautical engineer. What am I today? I'm an actor, I'm a singer, I'm an author, I'm a producer, I'm an artist. How did I go from becoming an engineer to all of these things? I made choices, the choices that I wanted for myself. So that is my rule number two. Let your dreams fly. Give them wings. Be who you want to be just by being fearless. Now, opportunities. That's another important part of being fearless. They're a very funny thing, huh? These opportunities. They don't come very often. They come far and few in between. But when they do we recognize them? Our job is to recognize them and make the most of them. I look back on all the things that I've done and I marvel at the opportunities that came my way. Miss India, Miss World, when I was in Bareilly in Army School, my first film offer, my first music single, the first film I actually produced. There was never a plan, ever. More like the universe sort of guiding me towards these opportunities. All I had to do was recognize them and make sure I worked so hard that I squeezed every drop out of these opportunities. This, ladies and gentlemen, is called drive. It's called ambition. So no matter where you are in life, rule number three is you have never arrived enough to explore new opportunities. And there's nothing wrong with being ambitious. Ladies, listen to me. Now, for all of you guys who like everything in life, I don't think there's anything wrong with wanting to have the whole cake and eat it too. Nothing wrong. I want everything. Mujhe sab kuch chahiye. And there's nothing wrong with that. As long as you're not harming someone or doing something wrong, don't be scared to want more for yourself than you ever thought you could. I'll give you a small example. A few years ago, I was shooting a film called Dawn 2. You've heard of that, right? So it was chosen to be shown at the Berlin Film Festival, Berlinale, and my entire team was flying for the premiere, and it was a very exciting time. But at the same time, I was invited for the first time to attend the Grammy Awards in LA. So now, and I was doing music, it was this big choice. Both the events were literally taking place one day apart in completely different time zones, Berlin and LA. My team and everyone around me told me, no, it can never happen. You have to choose what is your priority. And you know what I did? I made some insane connections. Mumbai to London, London to Berlin, Berlin to Amsterdam, Amsterdam to LA, LA to Mumbai in 3 days. And I made it happen. I went to both events and I looked great at both events. Even though I hadn't slept, it took a little bit of extra makeup, but I was fine. And that's not the only time I've done it. I've done it so many times, over and over again. Why? Because I don't want anyone to tell me I can't have everything. I want to dream of everything and I'll have everything. So rule number four, be greedy. Be greedy for your ambitions. Be hungry for it. Don't live on someone else's benchmarks. We are told so many times in our life, nahi, ladki to is ladki ko to ye karna chahiye, ya tum ladke ho sabse bade, your responsibility is this, this is who you should be. Who can tell you who you should be? Don't let anyone or any situation dictate to you who you are and who you can be. I know it's very much easier said than done. I know that because I've done it. But fight for your dreams. Because no one else is going to fight for your dreams except you. I've turned down so many roles, opportunities, because they did not fit into what I thought at that time was the right thing for me. So today, my path is just my own. It belongs to no one. My failures, my successes, all of it, mine. My journey, all of it is mine. So rule number five, do not compromise. Do not settle on your dreams. Now, who likes to fail? What? What? At least 15 logon ne haath uthaya. I'm really confused with this audience right now. That you like to fail? Well, I'm not talking to you guys then. I'm talking to those guys who hate to fail. Because I hate to fail. It's really as simple as that. It takes tubs and tubs of ice cream, lots of tissues, lots of tears, lots of dramebazi, my mother, my best friends, my family, everybody making me feel better about it. But the one thing that is as certain as night and day, ladies and gentlemen, is that you will fail. It's just how it is. And there is nothing that you can do to stop that. It's what you do after that'll define where you go. When something I've invested, thank you. Thank you. When something I've invested in my heart and my soul, which I do with everything that I actually put my mind to, if that fails, I don't just wallow in self-pity. I roll myself in it. I roll around in it. I wrap myself in it, head to toe, self-pity, self-pity, self-pity. It's not a pretty sight. I can tell you that. My mother, who's sitting right here, has witnessed it many times. But then I get up, cry a little, dust myself off, and dive straight back into life, because the only way to push failure aside is to move ahead, not ignore it, analyze it, and learn from it. Always remember, you will never truly enjoy success until you have tasted failure. And trust me when I tell you, it tastes like shit. Really does. So rule number 6, fail, fail, fail again, and then rise like a phoenix. Now, what is life without a little bit of a risk, right? No, I'm not an adrenaline junkie. I'm not telling you to go off roller coasters or anything. I've always believed that you have to take risks, calculated, educated risks, to evolve. Because if you've not truly explored the full extent of your possibilities, you'll always remain stagnant. People have written me off several times in my career. Sometimes they didn't agree with my choices. When I played a negative character in my film Aitraaz, very early in my career, I was told I'll be a vamp and no one will cast me as a heroine. When I took on a female-centric film called Fashion, again, very early on in my career, I was told that was not norm. When I signed a US TV show at the height of my film career in India, each time, the risks were huge. The stakes were high, and the repercussions could have been, to say not the least, career-ending. Thank God they weren't, and I'm still standing in front of you. I really appreciate God. I don't know what will happen going forward. But as of now, I can say that my risks and the gamble was worth it. You know why? Because I backed up those risks with my 100%. So rule number 7, be bold and take these risks. Now, friends, family, the people you work with, the people around us are our greatest influencers in your journey to success. So you have to choose very wisely. Rule number 8, surround yourself with the right people who do not stab you in the back. Now, who's into social media? Who's on social media? Raise your hands. Yeah, we like it. I like it. We can raise our hands. All right, it's almost everyone. Now, keep your hands raised if you have ever been upset by, like, a bad comment that you may have read on a photograph or, like, on Facebook or when you've posted something. And sometimes, you know, it's like, why do people have to be mean? Yeah, so there's a lot of you, right? Guys, please let me just tell you this. No matter what you do, someone will always be unhappy. Always. Especially in this age of social media, it's so easy for us to be confused between the voices that actually matter and the opinions of faceless people writing behind the anonymity of what the web offers. They don't matter. So rule number 9, you can never please everyone all the time. And the biggest favor that you will all do to yourselves will be to laugh at yourself, at situations. Find a moment to appreciate every single day this funny thing called life. And that's my most important rule number 10. Don't take yourself too seriously. We're not making rockets. All right, calm down, have fun. And just enjoy this beautiful journey that we've been put on. I do that. In the meanwhile, hi. Main yahi hu, main jaan hi rahi. Do aur rules bache hain. It's really not that hard, in my experience, to be kind, to be compassionate, to be human. You will never know someone else's full story. So don't be quick to judge. My mother, who's here tonight with the rest of my family, this entire front row is very Chopra and Akhori right now. She taught me when I was very, very young that there is always someone who will be less fortunate than you. Always. So give back wherever you can. There's a huge reason I started my foundation. I lend my voice to UNICEF, Girl Up, and causes that I'm associated with, because we have one world and it's ours. And we need to heal it. And that starts with us. So that is my rule number 11. Give back. And finally, the most important one. Always remember where you came from. It's truly what defines you. So I'm a proud Indian, an army ki beti, daughter of two doctors with a middle class upbringing and ginormous families who I love on both sides. We've seen good times, we've seen bad times, we've seen hardships, we've seen pain, laughter, sadness. But that is what has made me who I am. And I wear that with pride every day and everywhere that I go. So last and definitely not the least, rule number 12, don't ever forget your roots and where you came from. I hope you take some of what I have shared with you today and go into the new year with maybe a different perspective on life and start 2018 with being fierce, fearless, and flawed. Yeah, that's it. That's it. I read this somewhere and kind of stuck with me, and I hope it'll stick with you. Life's journey is not to arrive at your graveside safely in a well-preserved body, but rather to skid in sideways, completely worn out and say, holy shit, that was a ride. That is how I want to go. So to sum up this incredible journey that I have been on, I stand before you today, weathered by life, but happy and raring to do so much more. I'll see you on the other side. Namaste.
That was spectacular. May I now invite Sonia Singh from NDTV up on stage so we can have the conversation. Thank you.
So it's been an absolutely amazing lecture, Priyanka. Congratulations. I know it's not easy. It's a tough one. I mean, Amartya Sen, et cetera, I've done it before. But just good evening to an amazing audience, and good evening because we have this dialogue with Priyanka Chopra, a very special one, because Priyanka, I rarely say there are people who need no introduction, but you're one of them.
Thank you so much, Sonia.
Thank you so much for this conversation. How would you introduce yourself? How would you define yourself? Because there's so many parts to this person called Priyanka Chopra.
I've never been able to define myself because I feel like I want to be like water. You put me anywhere, I take the shape of it. So that's who I want to be. Inexplicable.
Superstar.
They have definitions. Chalo. Yeah. Aap log bolo na how you define me.
Superstar for sure. And so
savage.
Many. It's savage. But superstar. I think that really sums it up in so many different ways. In everything you've ever tried. And when we're at this Penguin annual lecture, which says chasing a dream, what are the dreams you're chasing in 2018?
I've always had the same dream, but it manifests into different things. And my biggest dream is to leave behind a legacy. I want the people who have loved me, people who have shown faith in me. Look, I'm a simple girl who came out of army school from Bareilly. I represent each and every one of these people who's sitting here today. Because if I can be sitting here, every one of them can. And that's the dream we chase, right? Mm-hmm. The dream we chase is to not have a tangible, ki mujhe gaadi kharidni hai, or I want to be able to get these many zeros on my check. Mm-hmm. For me, it has always been much bigger than that. It's a bigger picture. It's to be able to, every one of my fans or people who are well-wishers, to turn around and say, yeah, that was the right reason we loved her. Mm-hmm. She was an achiever. I want to be able to break through glass ceilings, I guess.
I'm just going to pick up that bit on the zeros on the check, because of course, Priyanka, congratulations. Another first for an Indian actor, that you're on the Forbes list of power women. Forbes list of power women, number 8 international actresses at 10, number 7 at $10 million. So, Priyanka, do those zeros matter?
Yes, because I work very hard for them. And I'm not someone who's been given... I wasn't born with a silver spoon, even though my parents always gave me one. Mm-hmm. But I worked really hard to be where I am. And I think each one of us deserves to be compensated for it.
That's actually really good, because that's one thing women tend to do. We tend to undervalue ourselves. We're not the ones asking for raises. We are like, oh my God, there is that glass ceiling out there. So in fact, you're also on the Forbes list with Shah Rukh Khan, etc. You're the only Indian woman out there. So that's actually something you feel that you need
the
to value
yourself. The only
woman,
yeah, on a men's only list.
Exactly. Yeah. So do you think that's really a sign of the value you put on yourself?
I was extremely proud. You know, it's so funny, and I want to bring this up because there was there's so many people who talk about the kind of numbers apparently I get for a certain minutes of my time. The boys are never asked that question. Their zeros are ridiculous. Have you even seen their zeros that they get on their checks? So, matlab, we should be celebrating that at least there's one girl who's gone out there and said, my question is, why aren't there other females on that list? Mm-hmm. I mean, again, it brings up the whole question. I'm very proud. No, don't get me wrong. I'm extremely proud of myself that I've had the ability to work so hard that I can stand shoulder to shoulder with my male counterparts today in the top 10 of India. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it brings up the question that why is there just one of me? Why is there only one female actor when there are so many of us out there?
And of course, you had to go, in fact. You had to go, in a sense, to LA. You had to go to Hollywood to actually get that to happen. Because if you were in India, right, there's no way it was happening, despite the fact that Indian heroines are so integral to our...
That was the reason. Yes, and you've pointed it out, so I'm thinking about it right now. But yeah, maybe that's the reason. I mean, Indian film actors, female actors, are so integral to our movies. But it does. And this is a problem worldwide. It's not just in India. You also see people talking about it, not just in the entertainment business, but even in business. Everywhere you go, there are very few females who get to break that glass ceiling and get paid in compensation for their work. But whereas when it comes to men, there's a certain entitlement to it.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And you're right. It's exactly the same in India and the United States. The same battles being fought in so many different ways. You've got a really interesting perspective now, because when you're there, you can look at it from an outsider's point of view. And when you come back, even though you've talked about being close to your roots, you've also got a whole new perspective. What's it like for you being an actor when you're in Hollywood or when you're on the TV sets there? And when you come back here and you're on the sets here, how do you actually look at it?
It's culturally very different. Whether it's films or television there and whether it's films or television here, each country has its own culture and we deal with it that way. My biggest problem with working in Hollywood is sab time pe aate hain yaar. Badi issue hoti hai mujhe. No, but they're like 7:18 a.m. and people will arrive at 7:18 a.m. So just to irritate the ADs, sometimes I come at 7:17. Did I come early? Or but at the same time, that's my only issue. But otherwise, I feel like the crazy of filmmaking is pretty much the same wherever you go. You know, you still have a director who's waiting for the actors to come out of the trailer. You still have assistant directors standing outside the trailer and saying, "Arey madam, jaldi aao." Mm-hmm. You still have the bichara producer who's saying, "Jaldi aaj ke sare scenes khatam ho jane chahiye." It's the same thing everywhere. It's just culturally different.
Here's one difference I'll put out for you. Maybe in some ways things don't change at all. I remember in 2015 when you were back here just after Quantico, and there was that whole Bajirao Mastani, and you were here for the promotions. There were also that craziness, those kind of hostage videos. And you said, look, I can't stay silent anymore. Why are films and actors always political pawns? Now in 2017, it's a movie Padmavati with the same director, and we are back to square one in a sense. That's different.
It's the same, right?
No, but that's different.
Different from America.
In the world, yeah.
अच्छा आप मुझे देख नहीं पा रहे सॉरी
सो एडमायरर्स इन ऑल एजेस दैट्स नाइस एडमायरर्स ऑफ ऑल एजेस
आई एम सॉरी सर
एंड हिज वाइफ देयर एज वेल सो दैट्स ग्रेट
सॉरी सोनिया आई विल हैव टू लुक इन देयर डायरेक्शन अ लिटिल बिट
आई विल टू डोंट नो वन्स आस्किंग बट गो अहेड
आई डोंट वांट टू बी रिप्रिमांडेड अगेन घर पे काफी डांट पड़ती है मुझे
So back to that question, from Bajirao Mastani to Padmavati, nothing has changed in a way.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. I think the problem is not the comparison. Why are we comparing different countries? That country has its own set of problems, and we all know that too.
Sure.
Whereas we have our own set of problems. And we have to look into our own home and clean it, na? Mm-hmm. We have to stand by what we want to stand by. Do we agree with it? Do we not agree with it? Do we think that art should be a point of view? Are we living in a democracy? Are we not? These are questions we as young adults or we as the citizens of a civil society need to ask ourselves and then make changes. There's no point in pointing fingers to someone else's country and say it's better over there or it's worse over here.
Okay, so just as a young Indian actor, when you feel that somebody you know and have co-starred with Deepika Padukone, that someone can stand up and say, I'll cut off her nose, another one can stand up and say, I'll behead Sanjay Leela Bhansali, what do you feel as an Indian actor?
I feel like I should call them up and tell them my point of view and say that I stand by you, which is exactly what I did. I called Sanjay sir, I spoke to Deepika, and I've always told them that, you know, you have my support in everything that you stand for, and I hope that this, you know, this film can be seen and eventually everything gets cleaned out and, you know, the art that Sanjay Leela Bhansali stands for can be viewed by everyone. I just hope that happens.
You made that point earlier about actors becoming political pawns. And what's true is that if you actually say that publicly, they become so much kind of back and forth and kind of online vitriol, which you just talked about, that often the issue gets diverted. Why wouldn't you say the same thing publicly?
Say what, sorry?
Like, for instance, you said you'd call them up and express support, but as an important voice in the film industry, would you say the same thing publicly? Because most stars have stayed away from saying anything publicly.
You want me to actually answer that question, Sonia, truly?
Sure, because you're flying out soon, so that's why.
No, not because of that. Not at all. I'm not afraid.
No, I'm saying that's why I would recommend you answer it.
No, it doesn't matter. The internet follows you everywhere. Mm-hmm. Because when you put my name, or when you, as a media house, put my name or a public person from the Indian film industry onto your ticker, people watch it. Mm-hmm. So we are used. So it's not on me or it's not on us. It's on you.
But let me just ask that exactly.
Hence you asking me this question four times when we were about another film and another filmmaker instead of my life and my career.
No, sure. But just to actually put that out there, Priyanka, that I'm not actually asking you because I want the headlines or the TRP of it, but just because you are a voice that matters. And I think, again, why Meryl Streep would speak out in America or why Rose McGowan would speak out.
So answer me that question.
Whatever.
Have you not seen what, with the polarization that we are sort of dealing with in many, many different ways, not only when it comes to religion, but when it comes to gender, when it comes to everything that's happening in this country, mm-hmm. Why is this question not always asked to the politicians or the government who's actually responsible instead of actors? What can an actor, a filmmaker, do to change what is happening in the country? I'm as much of a part of civil society as you or them.
I absolutely agree with you.
It's not my fault or my reason. So I can have an opinion.
Sure.
I don't need to be pushed into a corner to give it just for me to become a scapegoat.
No, exactly. But I would say that I think politicians and government are questioned by media houses, including ours. But I would say let's get back to your life and career because that is important. But I think it's also important.
Thanks,
what you
Sonia.
Say.
Yes. It is important now.
Yes, because it is.
I appreciate it.
Because it is. It is, of course, what we're discussing today as a thinking young woman. And just to come back perhaps to again something we're talking about, which the film industry and talking about being a woman actor today. How is that? Because again, in Hollywood, we're going through this whole kind of catharsis with actress after actress, the most powerful actresses we've all grown up watching, admiring, talking about experiences they went through. Do you see that as something which has struck a chord with you, with other Indian actors at all?
I think it struck a chord with everyone in the world. Like you saw what happened with the Me Too hashtag. It wasn't just restricted to America. It went all over the world. But like I said, different countries have different cultural boundaries. And we have different cultural boundaries. They have different cultural boundaries. Meryl Streep can stand up and talk against the president over there. I mean, they can sell anti-Trump memorabilia outside his house. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's a different way we live in our nation. And some people need to respect that. So yes, as women, and again, it's not just in the film industry, like we keep saying, I do not understand. Because again, the film industry gets written and spoken about a lot more. But if you talk to so many women out there who will I'm just going to ask you to raise your hands. How many of you have actually, in some form or the other, whether it's emotional, verbal, physical, sexual, have faced abuse from a powerful man in your careers, in your lives, in your future? Whether they have said something to you, whether they have taken you for granted, whether you've not got a promotion. There are so many ways. Look at the amount of hands that come up.
Yeah.
And that is just,
That is just society in general. And we live in patriarchal, mostly patriarchal societies all over the world. Mm-hmm. So we as citizens need to change mindsets by teaching our sons the values that the next generation needs to take forward. That are respecting a woman, when you respect a woman is when you're a real man, not when you tease one. Mm-hmm. So when our sons know that is when the generational change will come. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's going to happen overnight. I do think there are so many of us, like with the debate, the conversation happening, with it coming out there, there are so many girls who get the courage to be able to talk about it because you know someone is standing by you.
Yeah.
Only if you know someone is standing by you is it easy for a woman. It's not easy ever. Is it easier for a woman to come out and say, I was troubled or somebody hurt me? Because most of the time women are told they asked for it or women are told it was their fault when it's not. I wouldn't say they are victims, I would say they are survivors. But there shouldn't be a world where women have to survive. There should be a world where women thrive.
Shobha Day, who's here as well this evening, made that point. She said, what are we talking about Harvey Weinstein's in Hollywood? Look at how many there are in the Indian film industry. Others have talked to the fact that there's a veil of silence. Why is it that no powerful actresses have spoken up?
Shobha ma'am seems to know a lot more about it. Why didn't she take names?
True.
Why are you asking me? She brought up the topic.
Is it something you've ever had to face? Did you ever feel uncomfortable in your journey? You made the point that you were a small town girl who came in with no film industry contacts.
Yeah, but
at all.
I'm very feisty, so people get scared of me a little bit.
Fierce, that's the word.
I am. I'm a little bit fierce. When I walk into a room, I make sure that no one can... Yes, I've had situations where I've been thrown out of films because someone else was recommended. A girlfriend was recommended. I've been... After I've signed movies. So that's an abuse of power. Girlfriend of the hero or the girlfriend of the director. I couldn't do anything about it because I didn't have the power. I was removed last minute from many such situations because I'm not someone who caters to the whims and fancies of powerful men. I cater to my friends and my colleagues and people who give me respect. Mm-hmm. So I was treated a certain different way because I demanded it. And I didn't settle because I had the strength of my parents standing behind me saying, why do you need to be afraid? Mm-hmm. You don't need to be afraid, but there are so many women out there who don't have that support, mm-hmm. who don't have the support of their families, who don't have the support of their friends, colleagues, peers, who have to do this alone. And it's a very, very difficult journey. Mm-hmm. So for all of those women out there, find someone who stands in your corner. It'll give you so much strength.
And I think you've actually used, I mean, it's very important what you said tonight. You've used your voice of strength in so many causes. Now also the UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador, talked for refugees. Just recently you mentioned the bit about Meryl Streep and President Trump right now. But you've also made your views clear about the new refugee policy, the bit about it being a political witch hunt, as you wrote. You feel that you must speak on these causes. Why did you decide to write that? Because it
well, that
be
was about a year ago when
yes.
when the speculation was starting about the immigration policy. And I am on a visa in America, so I felt that I should have an opinion. Pata chale, I'm deported in like 1 month. So you never know. But I'm also opinionated, like all of you, like you, like me, like my mom, like Shobha ma'am. All of us were raised to have an opinion. Mm-hmm. We can't help it. We can't keep our mouths shut. So I took a chance and I wrote what I wrote. But I know there are so many other voices that have stood up against that and talked about equality and giving... immigrants an opportunity. And I'm so glad it's become a collective voice now.
No, and it's been actually been great listening to you on American talk shows. And when you've talked about the fact that when you studied initially in America, you did face some racism. But now you're back there really owning the space in a way of being an actor. And I thought the interesting bit you talked about is that you didn't want to be defined as an Indian actor, an Asian actor. You were just an actor playing the role. Tell us a little bit about that journey from perhaps some of the racism you faced and what it's like for you today as somebody who's honored by Time and global power lists, etc. It's come full circle and more.
Well, racism exists in a very big way all over the world, I feel. What does racism mean? Basically, judging someone else because of their race or because of where they come from. And yes, I faced it when I was in high school in a really big way because I was also an insecure 16-year-old who wasn't sure about what I stood for. I was the only Indian girl in my school and people used to call me Brownie. They used to say, there was one which was, they used to call me curry. And they say, oh, can you smell the curry whenever I used to walk past? Or, when you're 14, 15,
yeah, brutal.
It's really, really scary because, you look at yourself and you say, what is wrong with me? what can I change about myself? Not realizing that the fact that you don't change anything about yourself and still get the world to notice you mm-hmm. is when you're a success story, and that's all I did.
Mm-hmm. What for you in this year, 2017, has really been a year of so many different highlights. You've got a third season of Quantico coming up as well. What's been the biggest highlight for you this year? What has meant the most?
This year was very tumultuous, honestly, actually, if I may say so. I finished season two. I was going into season three. I finished two films in America. And at the same time, I did a lot of my philanthropy work with UNICEF. But at the same time, there was a strange experience I had in my film experience, where I realized that South Asian actors in international entertainment are still a novelty, a complete novelty. So I was at the Emmys, and I was presenting this year, and Aziz Ansari mm-hmm. won an Emmy for his writing for Master of None. Riz Ahmed won Best Actor in a Drama. First time a South Asian has ever won an Best Actor in a Drama in the Emmys. And we were at the after party of the Emmys, and Riz was standing, eating some burgers and standing and looking at the room. There must have been 400 people. It's a very exclusive amount of people that are called. And we were celebrating that there were four of us in that room. Just four South Asians in that room. But Aziz said, 8 years later, there was 8 years earlier, there was just one. So we are making we are making steps, and hopefully with people, whether it's me, Riz, Aziz, Anil Kapoor, Irfan, all the people who have actually gone out there and been successful in the work that they have done internationally, I pray and I hope that bursts open the doors for so much talent from South Asia, because we deserve it. We are 1/5 of the world's population. We damn well have representation in international entertainment. Mm-hmm. And we have to demand it now, and that's what I'm going to do. I don't want to be seen as some stereotype of my big fat Punjabi wedding. I want to be seen as a kick-ass actress. That's it. Nothing else.
But what's it like when you come back? Because in a sense, you've set the bar higher, as you said. You've set your own bar, your own standard. What's it like when you come back? Because, for instance, there's also this thing when a woman actor kind of becomes bigger than the hero, when she's the hero in a movie. How does that cope when you come back?
Well, I haven't done a film in India yet, that's why, I guess.
But are you finding that happens, that people think you're the Priyanka Chopra, so we can't kind of approach you for being, well, like the arm candy or the pretty woman in a Hindi movie?
But Sonia, I've always also chosen parts where I've never been the arm candy. I left that a long time ago. Mm-hmm. In my earlier films, I did do that. But then I took a deliberate choice to find parts in movies which actually were substantial, which gave me something to do. Mm-hmm. Which moved me and moved the people watching me. So I was relevant in a film rather than just being the pretty face. So that was something I did way before I went to America. But I guess now coming back, I think, I don't know about my career and my films. I definitely put on at least 3-4 sizes when I go back to America. Like, I've been in Delhi in the last 4 days, and all I have eaten is parathas, dal, and like really, really Indian khana and ghee. But that's the one thing that I really miss. I miss speaking in Hindi. I miss the language. I miss acting in Hindi. I miss dancing, which I've been doing a lot of. I look for a reason to do it now. But I think professionally, I didn't really feel that yet. Because the choices that I have made in my film so far, I feel like the Indian film industry has really appreciated what I have achieved so far. And so has India. I've got so much love and respect. And it really feels great because, you know, sometimes you think people will be envious or people will say, why her, why not me? But I've not got that. I've got so much admiration and love, and that suddenly makes you feel so humble, because I really feel like, you know, I did the right thing, not just for myself, but something which is much bigger than me.
You don't feel you've outgrown the Hindi film industry anyway, because we'd really miss you.
Well, I miss you too. I miss Hindi films too. Phir se ek strange sa sawal bolun. I'm going to get beaten up, I think, after this interview. My last film was Bajirao Mastani, which was about, and Ganga Jal, which was about 2.5 years ago. And what was Hrithik's last film? Or Ranbir's? How many years has it been?
Okay.
Nobody's asking the boys that question.
No one's asking the boys. So let me ask another question. I like the bit. You said, I promise you I'll get Hrithik and Ranveer and ask him that same question. But
no, they get the opportunity to take time to find the right film for themselves and come into a movie after 4 years and no one checks their relevance or asks them that. Why should my relevance be any less if I take that time? I'm still working in America.
For sure and for good. No, but just to ask, because you mentioned that bit about online media and what people say, and people are always going to say something. And interestingly, even about you delivering this lecture tonight, there were a lot of people saying, well, why is Priyanka Chopra delivering this lecture? Did you even bother about it? Or what would you tell them?
Shobha, they asked me to come here and I accepted.
Wow, that's easy as that.
There were a lot of people who wanted to hear me talk, and the ones who didn't don't have to stay. Bye. See ya.
Jessica, I know you're hugely busy, but also some stuff, because one, I saw you at the Met Gala and I loved what you were wearing, but I loved also the way you talk to the host and the journalist there, something like you're doing right now. But
when being sassy and witty.
Yeah, exactly. And not letting us relax anyway. So you asked, somebody said, so who's your date tonight? And you were like, why do I need a date? Tell us.
Exactly.
Tell us about that, especially because in India, I'm sure your mom isn't, but you know moms are saying, achha bete, you've done all this, you've achieved this, you've won this, but when you're settling down?
Actually, my mom is the opposite.
She seems super.
She said to me that you will only settle down when you have a man who appreciates all the work you've put into your career. And
I agree with you, Mrs. Chopra, that's great.
So when she said that to me, I just didn't feel any pressure. Of course I want to get married. I want to have a cricket team of children. But I do. I really do, and I'm a Cancerian. I love homes. I want that whole thing, but I'm not apologetic for my career at all. I've worked damn hard to take every single step. I've left my home, my family, my country. I've lived in a new country with no friends for like 3 years to be able to be where I am, and that was a lot of sacrifice. Mm-hmm. At a time in my career where I was the peak at my Indian film industry, it's a huge risk. So I'm not apologetic about it, and when the time is right, of course I'll do it. And when, देखो, मेरे लायक बंदा मिलना चाहिए, वो भी थोड़ा मुश्किल है ना.
I promise you, I asked Salman Khan this question as well. So this is not that was not a sexist one, but
No, for sure not. I didn't think it was.
No, but just to ask, because there's so many other exciting marriages, with Anushka, Virat Kohli,
and of course, so yeah. Sweet.
Yeah. And of course the Meghan, and she's a good friend of yours as well, marrying a prince there. So tell us, are you going to be a bridesmaid? What's your plans for that wedding?
I hate that everyone decides bichari ladki ne apne list mein kis kis ko dala hoga. I mean, the whole press has decided what her list will be. I have no idea. I don't know. I think the wedding is in May at some point. I spoke with Meg and I congratulated her. And I spoke with Anushka and I congratulated her. But I have no idea as of now. I mean, if you see me at the wedding doing the bhangra, you'll know I was there.
And you said, look, Meghan Markle's also the lead actor of Suits. So it's not about who she's marrying, but who he's marrying as well.
Absolutely. I've always said that. But I mean, it's really wonderful to see the two of them together, and Anushka Virat. I mean, it's such fairy tale weddings for both of them, and they're both my friends. So I really, really had fun seeing it happen.
We're not asking questions because Priyanka has to go. So last question tonight, Priyanka. What's so fun? You've had such an amazing journey. What's so far been your biggest the achievement that you would hold close to your heart? I've seen, of course, your tattoo of your late father. And I remember interviewing you many years earlier and talking about how much both his and your parents are being proud of you, how much that meant to you. And also, of course, what's your biggest regret?
I don't really have regrets, but I have to say, I think my biggest achievement, I feel, is honestly the ability to get over my fears. It's really scary to be sitting here in front of national television, in front of so many people, and thinking, did I say the right thing? Did I make a mistake? My biggest achievement is to make my vulnerability my strength, because I'm hugely emotional, and I get affected by a lot of things, and I know I come across as this tough, sassy, witty thing. But I do think that is a big part of keeping myself protected and surviving. I've always had to do it for myself. There's not been anyone who's held a safety net for me in all the decisions that I've taken. So I think my biggest achievement is to trust my feet, to trust my legs, to trust my instinct, and say, even if I fall, it's okay, it'll be my mistake. And my biggest regret, I think, would... I don't know. I didn't spend as much time with my dad as I would have liked, maybe. Mm-hmm. I guess. I don't know. That I regret. I wish I'd spent more time with him. Thank you.
I think your biggest strength, really, the millions of young women, young men who look up to Priyanka Chopra, role model for so many superstars, you said at the beginning. Thank you for talking to
me. Thank you so much, sir.